Having established excision and Meyer-Witry sequence, let us now give some immediate applications of Meyer-Witry sequence. The very first one is self-aware. Itself is an important result. It's called homology suspension theorem. There are similar results, homotopy suspension theorem, and so on in mathematics. The homology suspension theorem is much powerful than the corresponding homotopy suspension theorem, which will need more hypotheses and less and gives less conclusion. Whereas homology suspension theorem is very easily obtained and there is no hypothesis at all, you will see. Let X be a topological space. Then there is a canonical isomorphism, S. That's the standard notation, so I have to use that. From Hn twiddle of X to Hn plus 1 twiddle of Sx, n greater than or equal to 0, where this Sx denotes the suspension of X. The suspension of X can be written as the join of S0 and X, or you can think of it as a double cone, cone over X taken twice and glued together along X on the basis. So that is a suspension. So, on the first module, I have put a twiddle here. And the second one, whether you put a twiddle or not, it is immaterial because n is greater than or equal to 0, n plus 1 will be greater than or equal to 1. And then we know that the reduced homology coincides with the unreduced homology. So, you can put a twiddle here or not, doesn't matter. But here, twiddle is necessary for n equal to 0. If you don't put that, then this is not correct. So this is the first remark here. The suspension S is always path connected. And hence, H star of Sx is H star twiddle of Sx in positive dimensions. Okay, even including zero also. Whereas, if X is not path connected, then H naught of X, and you know, there will be problem about H naught of X and so on. So you have to put H naught twiddle of X, which will be different from H naught of X. Only H naught twiddle of X will be isomorphic to H1 of Sx. Okay, so putting twiddle is a must because n I have include non-negative the zero also I am including it. Okay, so Sx is the double cone. You can treat it as S naught join X. Okay, you can instead of minus one plus one, which is dangerous notation all the time. Whether it's a real number and so on, minus of something or so on, better to write as North Pole and South Pole. Okay, just like you are taking a sphere and then sphere is treated as a double cone over or a suspension over a sphere of one dimension lower over the equator. So you can take N of star X, S of star X, identifying around it on the common boundary. The first thing that you have to notice is that for any cone, this is the notation V star X, which is join of singleton point and X. We have V star X, you throw away the point V, it's homeomorphic to 0, 1 cross X. where 0 corresponds to this vertex. 0 cross x corresponds to single vertex. You could have the other notation, you could have pushed the 1 cross x to singleton point, then that would be different. So that's the question of notation here, which can deform to open 1 cross x, open 1, 0 cross 1 cross x can be deformed to 1 cross x, because 0, 1 can be deformed to singleton 1. So it follows that the suspension minus the north minus the south pole is, let us call it as A minus 1, and suspension minus the north pole, let us call it as A plus 1. These are both contractible. Okay, first you can deform all the 0 to 1 to x, and then whatever is left is a cone. So the whole thing is contractible. The inclusion map x, namely x cross 0, minus 1 to a minus 1 intersection a 1, is a deformation retract. You can collapse both the sides to the central equator. So the picture is exactly similar. If you take a two sphere and take x to be its equator, and the two sphere can be thought of as the double cone over this one. So you can keep that in mind. Okay. So A minus 1 intersection A plus 1 completely deforms to x. Okay. So these are the few things that you have to observe with the topological aspects here. Both A1 and A minus 1 are open subsets because you have thrown away a single point, namely the two vertices, respective vertices you have thrown away. So what we have is a mere unitary sequence now, because these are both open, so they form a excessive couple. So I can take HI twiddle of I plus 1 A1, HI twiddle of I plus 1 minus A1, A minus 1, the direct sum of these two. Then this is the union. Then the connecting homomorphism to HI, this is HI plus 1, this will be HI 1 lower. Again, the intersection here, then again direct sum and so on. Now, these two end things here, HI of A1, HI twiddle of A1, HI twiddle of A minus 1, they are identically zero. Why? Because they are contractible. So putting twiddle, even the zero thing is also zero. That's what you know. Okay, so this is zero, this is zero. This sequence is a part of a long exact sequence, so it's exact. That means this delta is an isomorphism. So from suspension to the intersection of these two things, which is the equator x, we have got an isomorphism already. Okay, so you have to put it properly. What you want to see, this here is an isomorphism like this, where delta is an isomorphism for each I. Okay, now being a retract eta for x to a1 intersection a minus 1, you can replace this one by x and by eta star. Eta star will be an isomorphism, right? So therefore, you take SS, the composite start with eta star from x to here, and then go back by delta inverse. So that is the map S, homomorphism S. Okay? Eta star is an isomorphism, delta is also an isomorphism, so I am taking inverse image of that, inverse of that one. So that S is from HI twiddle of X to HI twiddle of the intersection of these two to delta inverse HI plus 1 of SX. So you see, that is why the Mayer-Rutter sequence is called ready to use things. So all basic things you have done already. So it gives you the proof immediately. Okay. There is a word canonical. Why is it canonical? The inclusion map here is a canonical thing. Okay, if you have another y, a correspond a b and b prime and so on, the function x to y would have, this is a cross, this is something x cross 0 1 and so on, cone construction. The cone construction and the suspension construction, they are canonical. So the whole thing will be canonical. This eta is canonical. We know that delta is canonical in the snake lemma. This is coming from snake lemma, the connecting homomorphism. Whenever a pair of closed subspaces x1 and x2 is given, introducing intermediate pairs of open sets u1 and u2 such that xi is a deformation retract of ui is a typical way excision theorem will be used in practice. Convert them into slightly larger open subsets which will deform to the closed open set. So that's what we have done. If you take the two cones, they will intersect along x. Neither of the cone is an open set in the sphere, in the suspension. So what you do, you take a larger one. So instead of this whole cone, just take one point, the two poles, the vertices, one by one you remove. Okay, so that is a much larger open set. Now excision theorem can be applied. But as far as homology is concerned, it's the same thing as homology of this cone. So therefore it contracts. I mean, it's contractible. So the whole thing is zero. Homology is zero. Okay. So this is the way you can apply. So this is a standard way we can apply the excision theorem whenever you have closed sets. But this may not be always possible. For that, we have ready-made things like cofibrations and so on, which you have seen earlier. However, the simplicity of this proof brings some kind of mystery. So where, how to, you know, it's an isomorphism, but how to get this one? Whereas the topologically from X to SX is such a nice way of doing it. Can one do that? In principle, at least directly, in the sense that if you have some cycle here, can you suspend it and get a cycle here? Yes, we can do it. And let us do that one not now. That means I would like to give an explicit way, direct way of at least seeing what this S is at the homology level. We know that it's an isomorphism. We have no doubt about that. But how does it look like? At least in nice cases, at least, can we realize how it is? So this is here I am going to do it in much more generality, but then it will be explicit. Okay. So for this, you have to really know how the cones, etc. are formed. The first thing is recall that the cone construction is functorial, namely, when you form a topological space and then its cone, along with that, given a function f from x to y, there is a map which you can call it as cone of f, okay, cf from cx to cy. How it is defined? C of x comma t. Remember, cx is nothing but the quotient of x cross I. So I am writing this notation x comma t for the element which is represented by x comma t in x cross I. So take x comma t to fx comma t, the class of x comma t. This gives you the cone construction, which itself is canonical. Namely, if you have another map from y to z, which is g, then g composite f, c of g composite f will be cf composite, cg composite cf. Okay, so that is the meaning of it is canonical or functorial cone construction is functorial. Now, one more fact we want to use, namely, look at the n plus 1 standard simplex, delta n plus 1. You can think of delta n plus 1 as the cone over its subspace delta n. Okay, delta not a single point, delta 1 can be thought of as a cone over this one. This is a line segment. And then delta 2 can be thought of as, this is a triangle, can be again thought of as a cone over delta 1 and so on. So that is what I will use it. In this one, the apex of the cone corresponds to the next vertex, the extra vertex En plus 1. So here delta n up to E naught, even En is there. So delta n plus 1 vertex corresponds to vertex. So this is one way. You can use the first vertex itself as a cone and so on. The other way around also you can do. So different things will give you different cone construction here. Given any singular and simplest tau from delta n to x, so I want to attack this suspension map directly at the chain level. Okay, so chains are after all generated by singular and simplexes. Take a singular and simplex, that means a continuous function from delta n to x. This is tau n and tau s. I'm going to define two such things. Namely, if you look at the upper cone, namely x and star with n, the north pole, that will give you a cone construction of this tau itself, c tau. So because there are two of them, we may confuse which one. So you take c tau plus the upper part. So that will give you a map from delta n plus 1 to n star of x. N star x, that's upper part. Similarly, tau s, this is notation, what is this? It is c tau again, but the extra point, En plus 1 is going to s. So c tau minus, I will write it as delta n plus 1 star, wherein the c tau plus minus sends the last vertex En plus 1 to either n or s respectively. Okay, so there are two such cone constructions out of tau. Okay, and both of them are inside the suspension. Now what we do is, we'll take the sigma s, okay, instead of s, sorry, sigma tau as minus 1 raised to n plus 1 times this tau n minus tau s. You can ignore minus 1 raised to n plus 1 for the time being, then see why it is there later on. Just don't worry about that one. The tau n minus tau s I have taken. Automatically, this tau n minus tau 1 will be a cycle. Okay, you can start with your x as just two points, maybe s naught, minus 1 plus 1, and then take the double cone over that. That will look like a rectangle, but you have to think of that as s1 now, s of s1. So if you take the zero simplex there, okay, and take any zero simplex there and perform this thing, what happens? You can keep a track of this. Later on, I will give you a picture. Right now, this is what it is. Definition, tau n minus tau s is a n plus 1 chain. Tau was an n simplex, okay, singular n simplex. So when you make tau n, it is from delta n plus 1. So this is an n plus 1 simplex. So I'm taking a difference and putting a sign here. So it's a chain. Okay, it's a straightforward verification that this sigma gets linearly extended. I have defined it only on a singular simplex. If you put summation ni tau I, you just put that summation on this side also, that's all. Okay, gets extended to give a functorial chain map sigma from s dot x to s dot of sx. Okay, but only the problem is that it is of degree 1. You have to be careful about that. So it's degree 1 because tau, which is delta n, from delta n has gone, c tau is delta n plus 1. So an n simplex has gone to n plus 1 simplex. Okay. Once you have a functorial chain map, its chain map of functoriality is not necessary. Once it is chain map, it will give you a homomorphism at the homology level. Okay, you put a twiddle here. We claim that this is an isomorphism. This is nothing but this map is exactly same as the S there. And if you put a twiddle here, it will be an isomorphism. That isomorphism we have proved already. So I want to say that this sigma star is same thing as our S. Okay, so that should be very satisfactory for you, because now you know exactly how sigma or our S looks like at the chain level itself. Okay, that's a very satisfactory answer. Okay, let us do that. So remember, this S was defined as delta inverse composite eta star. So if I want to prove this one, it is the same thing as proving, put the delta on this side, delta composite sigma star is equal to eta star. Remember, what is eta? Eta is the inclusion induced map under this deformation. So it is like identity map as far as the homology is concerned. Therefore, what we are trying to say is delta star, the delta composite sigma star is like an identity map. So it's one is the inverse of the other. This eta star is just there because we have thickened X. Remember here, this one, eta star X has been thickened. But in homology, this is an isomorphism, which is actually, this is the inclusion induced map. So it is actually, you can think of this as subgroup, which is the full group. So it is an identity isomorphism itself. Okay, so don't worry about this eta star. Even if you don't mention, nobody, whatever. So that is what you have to think. Think that this delta star is inverse of, delta is inverse of sigma star. Okay, so in order to show that this delta composite sigma star is eta star, we need to go back, okay, to the snake lemma, go through the whole step, how delta was defined. And then you get it. There is no short way here to see how this is equal to this one, okay? Other than going through the step of what was the definition of delta. No theorems will give you. This is a theorem. Only after that. So you have to go back to the snake lemma, okay? So let me do that. So I have copied that thing in a slightly different way now. What are the things here now? There were this center two things were snakes part here, which was given by exact sequences. Okay. So this is S dot of A plus A minus intersection, direct sum, then S of Sx. Okay, this S of Sx was nothing but S of the image of A plus image of A minus by the excision theorem. We are able to replace it by Sx. So don't worry about how Sx looks like, but look like what it is. It is the sum of these two inside that. That is what we are interested in. Okay. So therefore, the entire thing becomes very easy here now. So how was the connecting homomorphism defined? From this kernel, you come here, this is an inclusion map, then you pick up something, then you push it down, then pick up something and push it down. Right? So take an element here, you come here. Okay, what is the element I'm taking? I'm starting with delta, I want to show delta of sigma star. So I start with sigma star of something. Okay. And then apply delta and see what is it. Whether I get back the same element. That's what we have to do. Okay. Starting with an element tau in Hn of x. instead of a singular simplex, now I have a chain which is actually a cycle, and then the representative class of that in tau, in HN. So this tau is represented by an N cycle, tau. Cycle means dabba of that is zero, right? It's in the kernel of something. Okay. And then we have sigma star of tau. Okay. And then I want to show that delta of that is again tau or eta, eta star of tau, whatever. It's, that's what you have. So sigma star of tau represented by what we have actually constructed, what is sigma star of tau? It is minus 1 raised to n plus 1 tau of n minus tau of s. Right? So this is an element of Sn plus 1 of the sum, which is a sub of Sx. Okay. Already it is represented by in this way as a sum of one in the upper part and one in the lower part. Therefore, j of tau n, comma, minus tau n. This j is what I am in j star, etc. I am just making it a simple notation, j of this. Now I have come here, this element. It is j of something here already. I don't have to pick up something myself. It is already there. Namely, it is j of tau n minus tau of s. Remember, j was a1, a2 was a1 plus a2. Remember that? Therefore, this element is nothing but j of tau n, comma, minus tau n. Okay? I am ignoring minus tau n, plus, minus 1 raised to n plus 1 for the time being, just looking at this one. Okay? You can change the sign up to plus minus later on. So now, look at the boundary. So I have come here. I have to take the boundary of that. The boundary of the direct sum is nothing but direct sum of the boundary. So I have to apply boundary here to get an element here. So that is what is boundary of tau n, comma, minus tau n, nothing but boundary of this plus minus boundary of that. Now you must know how to compute boundary of this one. This tau is some summation. For each tau, what happens? Boundary of tau n, the last vertex has gone to always to en plus 1. Okay. So you have to, how do you take boundary? You have to apply where is minus 1 raised to I, the fi, the phase fi is composite with tau. Sorry, tau composite fi. Okay. Right? That's what you have to do. So when you apply these things to first part of this part, you will always get boundary of tau, and the last one will be n plus 1. Okay. But when you apply the last phase, which will omit en plus 1, namely f of n plus 1, f of n plus 1, yeah, that will omit en plus 1. So then whatever is remaining is just tau. So this is minus 1 raised to n plus 1 times tau, because the sign has to change. So this is why that there is a common minus 1 raised to n plus 1 here. Minus 1 raised to n plus 1 tau. Because this is the coefficient of tau composite fr in the definition of dabba. Similarly, on the other side, there is a minus of tau of this one. It's boundary of tau extended by s minus 1 raised to n plus 1, again tau. Okay. Now, I started with a tau, which was a cycle. Therefore, boundary of tau itself is 0. Therefore, these two first terms here cancel out. I mean, they drop out. So minus 1 raised to n plus 1 is common. This is tau, comma, minus tau. Tau comma minus tau is in the precisely in the image of I. So here the I is a comma a going to a comma minus a. J was a1 a2 going to a1 plus a2. Those were the maps which we have defined in the Mayer-Vitter sequence. Right? So this is already, I know exactly what element coming here. It is nothing but tau. The proof is over actually. Minus 1 raised to n plus 1 cancels minus 1 to n plus 1. What you have seen, sigma star of tau, when delta, when you apply, is that tau is 1. So this is the procedure tau. You see procedure of defining delta. Starting from an element here, push it here, pick up an element here, push it here, pick up an element here, push it here. Pushing means here, whatever element you got, it must be read as modulo the image of gamma prime. So when you pass down, it is tau, represented by tau itself. Okay, and these kernel and these co-kernel are interpreted. What are they? You have to carefully say that in the definition, in the application. They are interpreted as what? As certain homology. Namely, this will be n plus 1 homology of this complex. And this will be, this n homology is n minus 1 homology in my notation. I should have started with n plus 1 here. Okay, because tau, all these things are n here, but actually n plus 1 and n minus 1 in the analysis here, HN I have started. Okay, so that's the difference here. So proof is over. Okay, this will also will give you now because you have shown that this isomorphism actually is nothing but sigma star, and verification that sigma star is canonical is very obvious, very easy. So you get another proof that the suspension isomorphism is functorial. So take a representative in the lower in X, suspend it is what I have to do. So take tau n and tau minus n, tau s, and take the difference. Whether you take this minus that, that minus this depends upon, but that will only change up to sign. So that won't matter much. Okay. So now you understand why I have minus 1 raised to n plus 1 I have put, so that I will just get I tau here. Next, let us do computation of the homology of SN itself. So first time we will be doing something non-trivial here now. Okay. Again, I have been telling you that SN is nothing but the suspension over SN minus 1. SN minus 1 suspension over SN minus 2. So finally, it is iterated suspension of S naught. S naught is what? Just 2-point space for which the entire homology modules we know. Okay. All the higher homologies are trivial. The zeroth homology for S naught, because it has two components, is Z direction Z. But when you take the reduced homology, it will be infinite cycle. Okay. Immediately, you will see that H1 of S1 is infinite cyclic. H2 of S2 is infinite cyclic. H3 of S3 is infinite cyclic, and so on. You would have immediately got that Hn of Sn is infinite cyclic, k equal to n. Whether you put twiddle or not, it is okay. Only thing is, the twiddle is necessary when you put n equal to 0. When n equal to 0 is S naught, which has 2 points, H naught of twiddle itself is Z, but if you don't put twiddle, it is not Z. It is Z direction Z. Okay, for that reason, you have to start exactly. Okay, so what happens to other homology? Let us look at H1 of S1. Okay. We know H1 of S1, just now we said it is infinite cyclic. But what is H0? H0 is, there is no information. It's not coming from this Mayer-Witter sequence. H0 depends upon number of path-connected components. It's path-connected. So H0 is infinite cyclic. But H naught twiddle I have put here, so it is 0. What happens to H2, H3 and so on? They are isomorphic under the homology to corresponding Hi minus 1 of the single point, S naught. So they are all 0. So above they are all 0. Therefore, we have proved this one for S equal to N equal to 1. Now you repeat this, what you will get is all the homology up to nth stage is 0. Nth stage it is Z, and again everything else is 0 beyond that. So this is the picture for SN. Once you have this, you can actually write down, this is what I meant by you should have this picture. So this is U comma V represents minus 1 plus 1. Okay, inside S naught. The zeroth sphere. And this is north pole, south pole. This is a suspension of that. Okay. You can think of, so you can think of this as a circle. Now, the sigma star of, I want to see sigma star of the zero thing. So, for S naught, what is the generator of H naught twiddle? It is just U minus V or V minus U, whichever one you take. Okay, under the augmentation, it must go to 0. That is, it must be a cycle. Okay, U minus V, this will generate the H naught twiddle of S naught. So that is G naught. So you pick up this cycle, which will represent the generator in the homology. Okay, take sigma star of G. By definition, now, it is minus of Gn minus Gs. Okay, write down it completely. G is U minus V, so it is Us minus Vs. I am now writing it as just like an edge, you see. Vs minus Un plus Vn. So these are the one simplexes. How do they look like? Look at Us. I put an arrow here. Okay. Minus Vs. Vs is like this. Minus Vs will be S to V. Okay. Then minus Un. Un is like this, but minus Un will be like this. Plus Vn, Vn like this. So they make perfect cycle. So the identity map, trace the circle exactly once. That is the generator for H1 of S1. Okay. So you have to think of this as a cycle, one cycle. That means it is sum of maps from delta 1 into S1. So this is the picture. Okay, like this. Now you can go from here to make a cone over, double cone over this one, you will get S picture of S2. Then you will get some of various triangles there, oriented triangles, correctly oriented triangles. Okay. So when you study simplicial homology, which we will do that, you will come again about this picture. Next thing is, we can now compute the homology of the pair Dn Sn minus 1. This time, we don't need mere arbitrary sequence. We just need long homology sequence of the pair. Okay, Dn is contractible. Therefore, if you take long homology exact sequence, Hi of Dn, this will be 0. Hi of Dn, Dn minus 1. Hi of Sn minus 1. The next thing again will be Hi minus 1 of, sorry, H, what is this? So this is a typo here. This is Hi minus 1 here. Hi minus 1 of Dn. So this must be Hi minus 1. Okay, so what we have is following. The long homology exact sequence, Hi of Dn, Hi of Dn, comma Sn minus 1, Hi minus 1 of Sn minus 1, to hi minus 1 of dn, this term and this term will be both zero. Therefore, this middle arrow will be an isomorphism. Since we have computed this thing, now we know hi of dn sn minus 1 is 0 if I is not equal to n, and third if I is equal to n. Okay, so when you are treating with the relative things, there is no need to put twiddles. So next example, I think we cannot do that example now. It's time, so let us stop here.